Mumba, the passing of Baba Tony Martin, and also the anniversary of the New Cross Massacre. So we spent a little bit of time just acknowledging those anniversaries, brothers and sisters, with our resident guest, Brother Leader Mbandaka, who is, as usual, in the studio. Greetings, Tenamwari, Brother Leader.
Tenamwari, Brother Shakira.
Yes, Brother Leader. You know, we always say that it's important that we acknowledge the great people, the great events of our history, all proud people, as we say, honor and celebrate those who have made a distinct contribution to our racial and cultural history. And so we look at the legacies of Martin Luther King and Milka Cabral. Martin Luther King's birthday, the 15th of January, and Milka Cabral's passing,
assassination
the 20th of January. Patrice Lumumba assassination, 17th sorry, of January. The passing of Baba Tony Martin, which 17th, is the 17th also, and also the anniversary of the New Cross Massacre, which was today, the 18th of
January.
And we also have another, which is the passing of Baba Obi Egbuna, which we'll go into a little bit later in the show. So we saved that one. But just to speak a little bit on these particular legacies right here, starting with Martin Luther King, I mean, very underrated and misunderstood figure in our people's history. Tenamwari.
Just as brave, bold, and courageous as all the others, different style, methodology, approach, perhaps not to the entire agreement of the nationalist Pan-Africanist sensibilities. We are nationalist Pan-Africanists within the Alkebu-Lan revivalist movement. So we wouldn't have agreed with all of his tactics and strategies, but certainly in terms of his commitment, his boldness, his tenacity, his love for people, and his courage. You know, he was, as I said, just as courageous as all the other great African leaders that we have had. And, you know, he left us an outstanding legacy of determined resistance against the indignities that we as a people were suffering, particularly in the United States of America. And I just want to say very quickly that oftentimes when Baba Martin Luther King is mentioned, his speech of 1963 at the march, or what do they call it again?
March of Washington.
The March on Washington. That's right. That one. You know, where he said, "I had a dream." But even the entirety of that speech is never the greater essence of that speech. You know, especially where he says that we have come to the nation's capital to collect a check. You know, a check that we should have collected, which we had received 100 years ago, but it came back saying insufficient funds. When we tried to cash that check, it came back saying insufficient funds. And, you know, so he was alluding to reparations. He was saying that the American nation owed African people some kind of compensation, some kind of payment, some kind of, they were liable to repay damage that had been done to African people. And of course, if we study Martin Luther King from 1965, after he went to Jamaica, went to the shrine of the most eminent prophet and king, Marcus Messiah Garvey, and paid homage to Papa Garvey and came back, you could see him evolving in a more, even more radical direction.
Tenamwari. I think just for listeners to know, I mean, if we had more time, we'd probably read a section of one of Baba King's speeches. But just to give emphasis to what you're saying, I urge the listeners, this is a speech that I've been meditating on since the 15th of January. If you go to YouTube and type in Martin Luther King, the three evils, you find a magnificent speech from Martin Luther King, where he speaks about the three evils being militarism, racism, and materialism. And he really does go in with a more or less revolutionary stance, even though he wasn't necessarily preaching revolution. But that was a necessary conclusion to everything that he was saying in that speech. And keep in your mind speeches of Papa Omowale Malcolm X as well, because he very much sounds like Omowale Malcolm X.
Absolutely.
In that
and,
speech.
And equally, and equally as powerful, and probably even more powerful speech, is the one that he made entitled "Why I Oppose the War on Vietnam." Exactly a year before his assassination. Being the 4th of April 1967.
Yes.
Exactly 1 year to the day before he was assassinated, he made that powerful speech where, amongst other things, he characterized the United States of America as the greatest purveyor of violence
yes.
on the planet.
Yes.
So true.
Well, I give thanks to that, brother leader. We also have the anniversary of the assassination of Amilcar Cabral, brother leader. One of the lesser known lights of the African independence era, but according to many of our historians, one of the key figures and probably the most one of the most forward thinking figures also, brother leader. Mm-hmm. Amilcar Cabral.
Most certainly from Guinea-Bissau.
Yes.
And you know, he was that revolutionary leader who was on the verge of leading Guinea-Bissau to its independence, mm-hmm. what they call it, independence. But he was looking much beyond the notion of independence. He was a revolutionary. He was a Pan-Africanist, and he was seeking to revolutionize the entire African continent. Mm-hmm. But of course, his primary fighting ground was Guinea-Bissau. Mm-hmm. He also was very instrumental. A lot of people don't know this, but he was a very close brethren or brother of Agostinho Neto,
right?
One of the founders or the founding father of MPLA mm-hmm. In Angola.
Yeah.
Both of them were students together in Portugal. And he was also instrumental in the founding of the MPLA. So he was certainly a man with a Pan-Africanist vision.
Yes, indeed.
And very strategic,
yes.
You know, very powerful mm-hmm. strategic and tactical mm-hmm. Mind, both militarily mm-hmm. and politically.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he is the person who left us these words, you know, that every...
generation.
I think that may have been Frantz Fanon
mm-hmm.
who said every generation must
relative obscurity
yeah. out of relative obscurity must discover mm-hmm. their mission mm-hmm. Fulfill it or betray it. Yes,
yeah.
I was
yeah, yeah, I think that's somewhere else. But he Amilcar Cabral did speak a lot about he's got a number of the one that's in my head is the one regarding claiming no easy victories.
Yes.
Yes. You know, and
that we must speak the truth to our people.
That's right. Yes.
And claim no lies, and claim no easy victories.
Right.
You know, tell the people the truth about yes. the rigors
yes.
of yes. liberation, fighting for liberation,
yes.
what must be sacrificed. This is what he was saying.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And we must claim no easy victories.
Yes.
He was a man who understood the value and the importance of culture.
Yes.
He put a great emphasis on culture, and he yes. also understood the value of youth,
mm-hmm.
organizing our youth for liberation. You know, he was the one that says the children are the flowers of the revolution, are the fruits of the revolution, the principal reason for our fight. Those are the words of Baba Amilcar Cabral.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
he emphasized a great deal of how important it is for us to channel our vision through the young people. We must have a program for our young people, and he certainly had that in the way he organized in Guinea-Bissau. Tendai Mwari.
One day we got to do a more comprehensive show on Amilcar Cabral.
Almost
for our listeners. Tendai Mwari.
It's more than worth it. You know?
Another stalwart of the African Revolutionary Era of a leader, and one of the Alkebu-Lan Revolution Movement favorites, is Baba Patrice Lumumba, assassinated on the 17th of January in the year 1961. Just a small word in honor of Baba Patrice Lumumba.
Yes, Tendai Mwari, Papa Patrice Lumumba. You know, he is an awesome revolutionary freedom fighter. He was the person who emerged as the first prime minister of the Congo, the person who led the Congo to its independence. Once again, a tremendous visionary. He is the person who Papa Omowale Malcolm X described as, you know, the most outstanding leader ever to emerge
mm-hmm.
On the African continent. That was the accolade that Papa Marcus Mosiah Garvey, sorry, Papa Omowale Malcolm X gave Patrice Lumumba. And in fact, he was so inspired by Papa Patrice Lumumba that he named one of his daughters, I think it's his fourth daughter, he named her Gamila Lumumba. he gave her the name of Patrice Lumumba. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Patrice Lumumba, as we know, was so swiftly removed from his premiership, his position as prime minister of the Congo, in a way that no other leader was removed quite so swiftly and quite so brutally. And that in itself is a measure of how much the global white supremacist world power feared Patrice Lumumba, because he was clear about his vision mm-hmm. for the African continent, his vision not only for the Congo, mm-hmm. but his vision for the African continent. This is a man who said, you know, we will not rest until every blade of grass and every particle of sand is firmly fixed in the hands of the black man and woman. You know, this is the man who made it very, very clear that the resources of the Congo was going to be put to the benefit of the people of the Congo and to the benefit of the liberation of the entire African continent.
Yes, indeed.
He made those words very, very clear for the world to hear. And in fact, so feared was he that at the inauguration of his government, the Belgian authorities who planned the whole thing mm-hmm. did not schedule the new prime minister to speak to the people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they scheduled the ceremonial president, mm-hmm. Kasavubu, mm-hmm. to speak instead. And Patrice Lumumba, when he heard what King Baudin of Belgium had to say, the insult that he hurled at the people by claiming that the colonization was, you know, a wonderful piece of work mm-hmm. by that mass murderer Leopold, mm-hmm. and Patrice Lumumba decided no, he couldn't suffer this indignity, he couldn't allow his people to suffer this indignity, and he just went and took the mic.
Yes, indeed,
and spoke truth.
One of the many things that he said in his many speeches, Brother Leader, Africa will tell the West that today it desires the rehabilitation of Africa, a return to the roots, a revaloration of morals. Africa will have no blocks as you have in Europe. Instead, there will be an active African solidarity. The government of Congo is a nationalist government that doesn't want imported ideologies, but which demands nothing but the total, complete liberation of the Congo. We have absolutely no intention of letting ourselves be guided by any foreign ideologies whatsoever. Mm-hmm. We have our own ideology, a strong, noble ideology, which is the affirmation of the African personality. Powerful words.
Let it be known also that we were informed by, reliably informed, by his grandnephew, who we had the honor of interviewing on one of our shows on a previous radio station. And he made it known to the African world through that program that Patrice Lumumba's grandfather mm-hmm. was inspired by the most eminent prophet and king, His Excellency Marcus Messiah Garvey.
Yes, indeed.
And was indeed a Garveyite.
All right.
So we can say that that Patrice Lumumba was not only touched by the majesty of the most eminent prophet and king himself, but was imbued with his spirit. Tendai Mwari.
Okay, we also, second to last for this show, this acknowledgements, the great apostle of the prophet, Brother Leader, yes. Baba Tony Martin, who passed away mm-hmm. On the 17th of January,
2013. Yes.
Yes, Brother Leader.
Tendai Mwari. And that was a big shock
yes.
to us within the Alkebu-Lan Revivalist Movement, as I am sure it was to the entire Pan-African world community when we heard the news of the passing of, as you quite rightly said, the apostle of the most eminent prophet and king, His Excellency Marcus Messiah Garvey. He was at the time the foremost scholar on the life and legacy of our great prophet. And indeed, he was anointed and appointed as the official historian of the life and legacy of Marcus Messiah Garvey and the UNIAACL by one of the students of Papa Garvey, the Honorable C.L. James, who was one of the President General, one of the graduates of Papa Garvey's School of African Philosophy, where he prepared leaders to carry on his work and his legacy. And he was at the time President General in 1986, I believe, when he appointed Baba Tony Martin as the official historian of the UNIAACL. And that was a tremendous loss to the African world community. He was a monumental figure in the history of African warrior scholars. His tremendous research and contribution to preserving the legacy of Papa Garvey and the history of the UNIAACL is second to none. And, you know, of course, we were fortunate within the Alkebu-Lan Revivalist Movement to host him on a couple of occasions and to have got as close to him as we did and to have got to know him as we did. And we certainly commemorate him on this day and give thanks and praises for his life and for his tremendous contribution to our history. Tendai Mwara,
give thanks, Reverend Leader. Last but not least, today is the anniversary of the New Cross Massacre, 1981. Very briefly, we're going to honor the lives of those who perished. There was a New Cross Massacre, Reverend Leader.
Tendai Mwara,
the New Cross Massacre. For the listeners who may not be aware, just a brief honor and a brief explanation of what it might be, what it is.
What it is, the New Cross Massacre is is an event that occurred on the 18th of January 1981, where a 16th birthday party, or the 16th birthday party of a young sister at the time by the name of Yvonne Ruddock, was subjected to a suspected firebomb attack, a suspected racist firebomb attack, resulting in a tremendous fire at the home, at her home at 439 New Cross Road, which claimed the lives of 13 young people on the night, and some of them died within a few days following. And a 14th was to jump to his death from a high-rise building as a result of mental afflictions that he continued to suffer as a result of the trauma he experienced on that night.
Yes,
that is a New Cross massacre, the worst single tragedy that has ever afflicted the African community here in the UK.
Yes, indeed. Tendai Mwara. So we want to send our continued love and blessings to many of the families of those 13, 14 young men and women who perished as a result of that fire. And we, as we know, brothers and sisters, we commemorate that particular event every year for the Black People's Day of Action in our procession aspect, understanding that the Black People's Day of Action 1981 was directly born out of the response to the New Cross Massacre, the African people's response to the injustice of the New Cross Massacre, and also the injustice in terms of the investigation that was done into the New Cross Massacre and other related injustices that African people were facing in society. So we're going to go into a little bit more about the Interim National African People's Parliament, the Black People's Day Action, later on in the show, Kings and Queens, so do stay tuned. Except we must also announce that it was on the 17th of January, thank you, Brother Kwame, the birthday of Muhammad Ali. For the brothers and sisters may not know that yesterday was also the birthday of Shabba Rankin, 50th birthday of the legendary dancer DJ Shabba Rankin. And one thing I forgot to mention last Sabbath was a man that we should actually hail out more, you know, but it was the birthday of the warrior general Baba Khalid Muhammad on the 12th of January. So we should hail up Baba Khalid Muhammad. I mentioned that last week. That's why I'm throwing it in now, Kings and Queens, seeing as we're in an anniversary kind of spirit. But yes, man, we have to big up Khalid Muhammad. You know, he's done a tremendous work and has had a tremendous impact and continues to on my generation of young activists. So we, you know, we're not on a Baba Khalid Muhammad.
I think he called himself or was called a Rockweiler.
Yeah, we many different things. The truth terrorist, you know what I'm saying? The liar killer, urban gorilla. Yeah. I gotta be a roughneck, you know what I'm saying? That was Khalid Muhammad. Yeah, you know what I mean? So it's a lot of different things, you know. So yeah, we got Khalid Muhammad, you know what I mean?
Tendai Mwara.
10 9 Warrior Kings and Queens, you're tuned into Africa Speaks with Alkebu-Lan on Galaxy Radio, the only de-brainwashing station, as we continue to talk it straight and make it plain. Our subject this evening is 50 years of black power in the UK. How are we doing? While the global African community gears up for the simultaneous memorials in Washington and London for Queen Mama Frances Cress Welsing on the 23rd of January 2016, this is the period of the year when we shall also be honoring a rather less known but vitally important activist nonetheless, named Obi Benue Egbuna, who passed away almost unheralded on the 20th of January 2014. For those who do not know, Obi Egbuna was an author, a playwright, and one of the architects of the Black Power Movement in the UK, a confidant and or associate of the likes of Kwame Ture, Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah, Maurice Bishop, Tony Martin and Fela and Nicola Pokuti. He was chair of the Reinvigorated Universal Coloured People's Association that drafted the Black Power Manifesto and was later instrumental in forming the Black Power Movement in the UK. As he mused in the introduction to his collection of essays and letters, Destroy This Temple, quote, "The history of black power in Britain is the history of the SHIT class trying to organize themselves. It was not until Stokely Carmichael's historic visit in the summer of 1967, when he came to participate in the Dialectics of Liberation seminar at the Roundhouse, that the Black Power got a foothold in Britain. In many respects, the work of Egbuna and others in the mid to late 1960s set the template for many of today's activists. They swept away much of the existing integrationist orientated groups that were revealed to be, quote, so steeped in infantile leftism, thanks to the Socialist Party of Great Britain, that they found it tough to appreciate the ideological and up-to-dateness of the Black Power philosophy." Reflecting his father's work, Obi Egbuna Jr. summarized its impact. "We also have to say, quote, that my father's work showed black power was a movement, not a slogan, as many like to say, because the nationalist and Pan-Africanist overtones were too aggressive for them," unquote. By Egbuna Sr.'s own testimony, assisted by their monthly Black Power Speaks magazine, the new philosophy, quote, spread like wildfire, unquote. Its success inevitably meant that the movement was subject to infiltration not only from the UK intelligence, MI5 and MI6, but also the CIA and even the apartheid regime of South Africa. A victim of these intrigues, Egbuna was charged in 1968 with advocating the murder of police officers and jailed for 6 months on remand before being released when the charges were dismissed. He continued his work and writings in the movement until his return to Nigeria in 1973. Then, as now, one of the key state tools against African attempts at self-determination is the police force. As a consequence, the recent announcement that the Metropolitan Police will add 600 more officers to its ranks to boost its terror response should be viewed in this context. The militarization of the UK police follows the examples of places like the USA and Brazil that have seen a proliferation of cold-blooded slayings, with the police literally emptying their cartridges on unarmed Africans. The experience in the 1990s of the Ring of Steel in London to combat Irish Republican bombings but disproportionately stopped Africans should raise some skepticism about the intended targets of police proliferation of police guns, not least with not least within the context of the increasing elasticity of the definitions of terrorism. One of the objectives of Black Power was to build a movement, not a series of heady campaigns that may bring short-term attention with often no lasting challenge. But no movement can survive without finance. And this has been the vexed question that has plagued liberation movements since the time of Papa Garvey, who provided the most comprehensive model yet. The Interim National African People's Parliament aims to tackle this particular issue head on at its next General People's Assembly on the theme Economic Empowerment, Key to Nation Building, taking place from 4:30 to 9:30 on Saturday the 30th of January 2016 at the West Indian Ex-Servicemen's Association, 150 Clapham Manor Street, London, SW4 6BX. The event will assemble some of the leading economic strategists and practitioners in the UK, for example Brother Robin Walker, MIMAM's African Cooperative Union, and the African Food Hall, with the aim of applying the INAP Economic Empowerment Manifesto to join up the dots towards creating the infrastructure for nationwide economic empowerment. However, it has been argued by the likes of Obi Egbuna that before we can transform our economic reality, a personal transformation is required. Quote, Black Power demands a total rejection of whiteyism, without or within. To talk Black Power, we must first clear up the mess inside our soul before we can effectively reject whiteyism in the street. We must first and foremost reject it within the very marrow of our beings. It must be rejected because it has no right to be there. To do things for ourselves, we must first make sure we are completely ourselves. Before we can confidently say we must first ascertain we really mean word. We oh, and word, not son. Half us and half them.
Come on.
Unquote. Word, so tonight son. We ask the question, 50 years of Black Power in the UK, how are we doing? Are you aware of the work of Obi Egbuna or read of any of his books? To what extent have we maintained the Black Power movement in the UK since the 1960s? Would more armed police make you feel safer? Are we really clear about who the government defines as terrorist? Do we really have to clear up the mess inside our souls before we can effect power? Can we point to an effective African economic empowerment model, past or present? Our special guest in the studio, Kings and Queens, is as usual our resident guest, Brother Leader Bandaka, spiritual leader of the Alkebu-Lan Revivalist Movement, ambassador to the UK for the UNIACL under the leadership of Baba Sengo Jawara Baye, co-chair of the Interim National African People's Parliament and independent African education consultant. We are hoping to also be joined by Obi Egbuna Jr., son of Baba Obi Egbuna Sr., who was born in London and raised in Washington, D.C. Obi has dedicated his life to organizing communities throughout the world. He is the founding member of the Pan-African Liberation Organization and technical advisor for the Pan-African Student Youth Movement. In addition to organizing and speaking engagements, Egbuna has published articles in the final call, the Chicago Standard, the Rastafarian Today, Hilltop at Howard University, and the Spectrum at Bowie University. Egbuna is the first U.S. correspondent to the Herald, Zimbabwe's national newspaper, and the first U.S. correspondent in the country's 32 years as an independent nation. Brothers and sisters, it's necessary for me to let you know that we've had some problems locking down our brother Obi Egbuna Jr. There's been some slight miscommunication which has resulted in his presence on the show being thrown up in the air, but we are still trying to ascertain whether we will make that possible today. Rest assured, if we do not make that possible today, we shall have our brother with us at a future date, Kings and Queens. So do stay tuned. We will let you know. But as and when we can get our brother in today, we shall do so, Kings and Queens. But it's I just to say shout out and give thanks to brother Obi Egbuna for at least agreeing in principle, Obi Egbuna Jr. for at least agreeing in principle to do the show, and we hope he's well wherever he is, and we do look forward to interacting with him either today or at a later date. But the brother is a very, very serious brother, one who is definitely walking in the footsteps of his father and definitely able to espouse on the legacy of his father. For now, brothers and sisters, we're going to interact with our resident guest, Brother Leader Bandaka. Tendai Mwari, Brother Leader.
Tendai Mwari, my beloved brother, my beloved son.
Yeah, so it's an interesting situation. I enjoy shows like this. I'm a student of the African Liberation Movement. Mm-hmm. And it's always important for us to learn more about the history of our movement, the trials of our movement, the challenges and the great historical figures, male and female, of our movement. And it would be true to say there were a number of articles that came out last year, maybe the year before that, speaking about the whitewashing or the wiping out of the history of the Black Power Movement in the UK. And I don't recall many of them mentioning the name of Baba Obi Egbuna, mm-hmm. very much. You understand what I'm saying? Like in the US, mostly the civil rights kind of leaning has, you know, a monopoly on the history of the African liberation fight over here. Mm-hmm. But just to first and foremost touch on Baba Obi Egbuna, in terms of without the presence of his son, just what we can say about him now. What is your understanding of the significance of his work and his legacy in the UK?
Well, Tendai Mwari, it's interesting that you should speak of him in terms of one of the unsung heroes. Yes. You should speak of him in terms of someone whose name has not appeared in an analysis of the rise of the Black Power movement here in the UK. Mm-hmm. And yet to know about this this now ancestor, mm-hmm. Is to understand that his role in effecting the rise of a Black Power movement, and we did have a Black Power movement emerge in Britain in the 1960s, in the late 1960s, and he was one of the pioneers of that movement. Yeah. Indeed, some may call him the father, mm-hmm. of the Black Power movement in the UK. And there's a saying that you can know a person by the company they keep. Mm-hmm. Well, you did a roll call of some of the people that you know, he rubbed shoulders with.
Some real bad man.
You know, you might want to repeat some of those names. Serious, you know, some Kwame Nkrumah.
Yes.
Some Kwame Ture.
And these are people that he actually knew and rubbed shoulders with personally.
Knew personally.
In fact, in I Speak of Freedom, Kwame Ture's book, In I Speak of Freedom, he has an essay in there called The Spectrum of Black Power. Mm-hmm. And he mentions Obi Egbuna in that essay.
Yes.
I think along with Michael X, as people that are at the forefront of the Black Power movement in the UK. He mentions him in the essay.
Yes.
So it was just a man that he knew personally.
Yeah.
But Kwame Ture, who again was as a student of Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah, and the key figures in the proliferation of Black Power in the USA. But this is a man that he properly knew personally, and his son Obi Egbuna Jr. was personally associated and, you know, grew up under the tutelage of Kwame Ture as well. Ture. Yes, I've heard him speak about this, so that's how I know this. Maurice Bishop, president of Revolutionary Guyana. Yeah. No, sorry, Grenada.
Grenada, yes.
Real serious man. You know what I'm saying? That again, we don't know enough about the Grenada Revolution. Mm-hmm. Not just the Grenada Revolution, but the Grenada Nation Building Program. Mm-hmm. Baba Tony Martin, who we paid homage to earlier in the show, number one historian in the life and legacy of Baba Tony, of Baba Marcus Mosiah Garvey, and Fela and Nicolapa Kuti, who is one of the most stalwart African revolutionary creative cultural freedom fighters we've ever had in our history. Mm-hmm. And so this is a roll call of some serious people.
Very serious people.
Who all knew and respected this man.
Knew him, respected him, spoke highly of him. Mm-hmm. And yet we as Africans in the UK know little or nothing about him. And it's because within the Alkebu-Lan revivalist movement, part of our work is unearthing facts and information, names of important individuals who have served our people historically in the Pan-African movement that we came across a few years ago. Mm-hmm. We came across the name and the works of Obi Egbuna, and we decided that we must bring this name to the fore. Yeah, we have mentioned him on Galaxy Radio.
Definitely.
And on another radio station before. Mm-hmm. We have mentioned his name. Mm-hmm. there's so many people I've spoken to and raised the name of this mm-hmm. of this Baba, and they know nothing about him.
Yeah, it's very serious.
You know,
it's very serious.
And yet he did a great deal to transform the landscape of African-centered mm-hmm. consciousness and, mm-hmm. And politics and resistance mm-hmm. here in the UK. And he's someone who came under sharp attack from the state as well.
Definitely.
You know,
definitely.
Was, you know, surveilled by the state,
yes.
was imprisoned by the state, yes. was brutalized by the state,
yes.
and yet we know little or nothing about him.
We're going to come back to the extent to which he was brutalized by the state, because mm-hmm. it's very interesting mm-hmm. in terms of how that took place. But I do want to say, in terms of, because a lot of people know, who have studied liberation history, mm-hmm. will know about the visit of Kwame Ture. He made a visit in 1967. But he also made a visit, I think the one in 1983 is more popular
mm-hmm.
In terms of, because I knew about that one. I was less aware of the one in 1967, although I did know about it. But mm-hmm. I think the one you hear, I've heard about growing up in the movement, is the one in 1983.
Mm-hmm.
But what Obi Egbuna is saying is that really it was that visit that gave Black Power a stronghold, 1967 one. Yeah. Even Kwame Ture is underrated in the liberation history
mm-hmm.
in terms of what he did to put Pan-Africanism and Black Power on the map, so to speak.
Yeah.
But it's important to know
that doesn't mean we agree with all of his politics.
No.
You know,
no,
but it's recognizing that he made a significant contribution.
And we're going to come back to that. Yeah. To that,
and that he was seriously committed to the liberation of our people.
Kwame Ture mm-hmm. is somebody is one of the few, like, I've met a number of people,
mm-hmm.
key, like, leading figures. He's one of the people that I never got to meet. And it's one of the things that I wish I had a chance to meet him. Because mm-hmm. when you see him as a teenager, mm-hmm. I understand that he died as an elder, still fighting absolutely. And evolving on this road.
Still
you
have to, in the fire.
Have to honor
absolutely.
That. And in terms
absolutely.
Of Pan-Africanism and the focus on Africa, mm-hmm. he done a lot of work in terms mm-hmm. of solidifying that focus
absolutely.
In many of our minds, you know.
Yes. And in terms of his consistency.
Always.
You know, that consistency, that
yeah,
determination.
Yeah, and optimism. You
know? And that,
he always, the eternal optimism. Full of revolutionary optimism.
that's
whenever you're feeling dejected in the fight, you know, listen to a Kwame Ture message mm-hmm. and he'll make you feel like the
liberation coming tomorrow.
You understand? Very, very serious. Yeah. But I think that international connection is important in terms of when we're placing the importance of the UK
mm-hmm.
in our liberation history.
Yeah.
I think if we look at the fact that the Fifth Pan-African Congress, which was
1945,
but mm-hmm. which is few people would deny that it was the most significant of the Pan-African Congresses,
mm-hmm.
Took place in Manchester, UK,
mm-hmm.
And this particular, even the time of Papa Garvey, mm-hmm. in terms of him traveling to the UK and what was happening in the UK at that time. In terms of Pan-Africanism coming through. The UK has always had a Pan-African trajectory,
mm-hmm.
Different to many other places that might be focused, especially in the States, might be focused on the African-American experience. Mm-hmm. But why is it? Do you think that is that the Africans in the UK have, generally speaking, had a Pan-African trajectory in terms of the global African community?
Well, I think one of the main reasons is that, you know, this is the brain center of the system of global white supremacy, and the role in particular that Britain played in the enslavement and colonization of African people,
mm-hmm.
that I think affected the way we approach the liberation fight here in the UK. You know, it's like, for instance, let's use a cricketing analogy for example.
Mm-hmm.
When the West Indies cricket team was it was in its heyday,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
you know, it saved its best performance,
yes.
and its most brutal,
yes.
thrashing,
yes.
for England,
yes.
And I think that's for a particular reason,
yes,
you know,
yes.
because there was a sense this was a very revolutionary time.
Mm-hmm.
We were coming out of the revolutionary 60s, and mm-hmm. still the spirit of revolution was still in the air in the mm-hmm. 70s when the West Indies cricket team emerged as the most potent force in world cricket.
Mm-hmm.
You saw Viv Richards, the best batsman team and the best batsman in the world, wearing donning his, you know, his red, gold, and green,
mm-hmm.
What you call it, wristband.
Yes.
And there was a spirit of consciousness that was flowing through mm-hmm. through the team. And there was certainly a sense that we were in the land of the colonial, the so-called colonial master.
Yeah.
And we had some scores to settle.
Yes.
You know, not just some sporting scores to settle, yes, but some political scores some to settle scores. And some cultural scores to settle.
Yes, indeed.
And so, you know, and it wasn't necessarily always in the forefront of our thinking, but no, it certainly was
In the subconscious.
In the subconscious mind, it was certainly integral.
Yes.
And I think that has something to do with it.
Yes.
You know, that this being,
yes,
the home, if you will, mm-hmm, of the so-called colonial master, the slave master.
Yes.
When we came here, we had scores to settle.
All right, Tendai Mwari. So we're going to do two things now. Yeah, we're going to explore ideology in the movement, and we're going to deal with the creative aspect, because Baba Obi Egbuna was a playwright, a poet, and so is his son. And the more I study the man...
And his son is a teacher as well, a school teacher.
And the more I study him, the more I see a synergy with him, because he's the template for a lot of the work that I am doing now as a journalist, as a writer, as an artist. And you know what I'm saying? And we're going to come back to that, because that's a very important thing.
Right. Sorry, I've been meaning to just throw this in very, very quickly. We were talking about the... earlier on, we were talking about the value of Obi Egbuna.
Mm-hmm.
And we were talking about the kind of company, you know, the company keeps, and the value of him to the Pan-African movement here in the UK and around the world.
Yes.
It was a piece of work that he did, a piece of writing he did,
mm-hmm,
about the Biafra War.
Yes, yes.
That the Osagyefo
War on Nigeria is called. Yeah.
Couldn't remember the title of it, but the Osagyefo came across that piece of work. And actually reached out.
Yes, to him,
to Obi Egbuna.
Yes, yes.
Which goes to show, mm-hmm, the power, mm-hmm, and the quality of the man, yes, and his thinking capacity,
yes,
his analysis,
yes,
of our plight as a people,
yes,
and he was very comprehensive,
yes,
in his thinking and in addressing the issues, mm-hmm, that were affecting African people, and very global,
yes,
in his analogy. So I just wanted to just throw in.
Very important, you know? Very, very important, brother leader. And I think we should know, Tenamwari, brothers and sisters, that brothers and sisters can go to our show spec of Africa Speaks with alkebulan.org/Africa Speaks. And many of some links to some of his writings are contained within the show spec, Kings and Queens. All of his writing, all of his books, all of his plays are actually out of print at the moment.
Yes.
And I know his son is trying to, you know, rectify that particular injustice.
Mm-hmm.
But the man sounds like somebody that just requires more study.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to delve into that a little bit at the moment, brother leader. Because as we know, the movement of the 1960s, not just in the UK, but globally, carried the socialism was the dominant force in the movement at that time, and it seems that many people say that Baba Obi Egbuna had Marxist leanings, or was influenced by Marxism, or had socialist, you know, leanings, but he seems to be a fierce critic of socialism. He appears to be far more championing a nationalist agenda,
mm-hmm,
or philosophy. So let me just give one quote from the spec. He says that so steeped in infantile leftism, this is the movement in the UK now.
Yes,
and
yes.
Not just a socialist, mm-hmm, but the more civil rights aspect, mm-hmm, yeah, which is leaning left.
Mm-hmm.
But he says thanks to the Socialist Party of Great Britain that they found it tough to appreciate the ideological and up to dateness of
the black power
philosophy. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Brother Obi Egbuna Jr. says, we also have to say my father's work showed black power was a movement, not a slogan, as many like to say, because the nationalist Pan-Africanist overtones were too aggressive for them. What he's saying is people tried to reduce black power to the slogan because they didn't want to deal with the practical elements of it. They'd rather just reduce it to that.
Mm-hmm.
He spoke about the last quote was in terms of whiteism, and I want to get there's another one in terms of the education system. Let me see if I can get this one up. But it just seems to me that he was challenging the emphasis on Marxist ideology,
mm-hmm,
in the movement, brother leader, which is an age-old fight. What's the significance of the fight in of that particular debate within our community, first and foremost? And then we'll get back to Baba.
Profoundly significant. I mean, last week we were dealing with the legacy of Mama Frances Cress Welsing. And she herself tells us that she had become a Marxist.
Yes.
And she realized that Marxism was very, very limited in providing a proper analysis of the challenges that face us as a people, not least because Marxism is exclusively, it's an analytical framework. It's exclusively based on the on class analysis, almost exclusively, one should say, and gives very little credence to the role of race or a race analysis. Really has no substantive race analysis. And she realized that that was profoundly inadequate. She said, in fact, she said that when she, you know, she started going to university, she came home to her parents and her grandparents and said, I'm a Marxist. Her grandmother looked at her and said, well, the more you get educated, the more foolish they become, or the more they become fools, or more dumb they become, or something like that. You know, because Marxism was never intended to provide a tool of adequate analysis for the experience of African people, the suffering of African people. It was never intended to be a tool to empower us or equip us for our liberation.
But what's the fundamental differences between the Marxist, quote unquote communist, quote unquote socialist ideologies and the nationalist? What's the major difference?
Well, I've already suggested that the Marxist analysis is a almost exclusively class analysis. The Marxists will analyze the oppression of African people from the perspective of workers within the capitalist system who are being oppressed as a class of people, and exclude from that analysis the role of race,
or minimize,
but oftentimes even exclude.
Yeah, no, I agree.
You know, the role, the role, or the primacy of race in the experience and the suffering of African people,
and also the solution
and
the liberation.
And I was going to go on to say, and the need for a substantive race analysis, and the need for African people as African people to organize exclusively based upon our own agency to forge our way, empower ourselves and forge our way to our own liberation. If we follow the Marxist class analysis, which is European determined and Eurocentric in its nature and its analysis, what we will find is that we will be led by Europeans, albeit European leftist thinkers, European socialists. We will be led by them because it is a Eurocentric theory, it's a Eurocentric philosophy that is based upon the experience of Europeans within their own system of oppression.
All right.
And it may well be valid for Europeans. Yeah. There may be elements that are relevant to us as African people. But as the most eminent prophet and king, His Excellency Marcus Messiah Garvey, says, hear all, but attend only to that which concerns you. Your allegiance shall be to your God, your own race, and your own country, and your own people. Marxism doesn't give us that kind of analysis. All right. Well, workers of the world, unite. And fight, not Africans of the world. Unite and fight. Tendai Mwari.
So we're going to come back to defining black power and nationalism more specifically in a sec. But just to say, this is another quote that kind of explains Baba Obi Egbuna's position. He says, nobody in his right mind disputes the fact that the white worker is a prey to capitalist exploitation, as well as the black worker. But equally indisputable is the fact that the white worker is exploited because he is a worker, not because he is white.
Yes.
While in contrast, the black worker is oppressed, not only because he is a worker, but because he is black.
Absolutely. Yeah?
And this is interesting. And we're going to come back to the...
And that's what you call a race analysis.
Right.
So what Obi Egbuna, for all the... despite the fact that he is often described as a Marxist, is actually challenging and exposing the contradictions of Marxism as it relates to the experience of African people, and as it and in terms of its relevance to African people as a tool of liberation. He's basically saying to us that it's totally inadequate.
Yes,
you know. That is what he's and what he is giving us is a race analysis of our situation as a people.
Tendai Mwari. So this is very important. We see so it seems as though what he was doing, because it seems like he was challenging a particular perspective mm-hmm. that was popular among our people. Mm-hmm. And what's interesting is that I don't know the extent to which he defined himself as a Marxist. Mm-hmm. I believe there is some scope for suggesting that he did define himself as a socialist, and we're yes. going to come back to that in a second. Mm-hmm. But I do believe that one of the issues, and I think one of the reasons why Baba Obi Egbuna's legacy is not known enough, mm-hmm. is that we have a tendency, or people have a tendency, in and outside of our community, to annex the intellectual development of our liberation or revolutionary ideologies as associated with this European figure, that European figure, this European movement, mm-hmm. or that European movement. So the development of our movement over here is closely linked to the Socialist Party or the Labour Party, depending on your perspective. Yeah, mm-hmm. And it's in all of our everything that we've done over the last 150 years must have come from mm-hmm. some form of Marxist ideology or another. There's not enough attention paid to independent African intellectual revolutionary development.
Yes.
First of all, are you
Haiti,
for example,
Palmares?
Yes. Yes.
You know, mm-hmm. and there are so many examples. Mm-hmm. You know, throughout the African continent, mm-hmm. In the Caribbean, you know, you have the Taki the Taki uprisings in the Caribbean, the Nani uprisings, the Maroons, so-called Maroons, the Caramantes that were so-called Maroons. There's so much evidence of African people organizing and analyzing our condition and forging our way to our liberation, mm-hmm. Forging ideologies
yes.
That helps us to think through and strategize
yes.
As far as organizing for liberation is concerned, mm-hmm. and yet we don't give enough credence mm-hmm. and credit mm-hmm. To that. We feel we have to rely on a European determined ideology.
Some might say, "Rather, what does it matter where we get it from, as long as it serves the purpose?" What is the importance of us having African intellectuals, revolutionaries that form the basis, the our primary inspiration for our intellectual and revolutionary development? Why is it that important? Why is that particularly important?
Well, because our experience is always going to be unique to us, mm-hmm. and people define their reality based upon their experience, and people determine the way to liberate themselves based upon their own vision, based upon their own objectives, and that cannot be fed to you by other people. No other people can. And the other thing is that's very, very important. No people will their own liberation than the people themselves. Yes. So that enthusiasm, that determination to be free must come from within the people themselves, and that is what is going to determine what ideology or what philosophy the people evolve. So it has to be based upon their own will. It has to be based on upon their own experience, mm-hmm. their own analysis of their own experience, and their own vision of what freedom looks like.
Yeah.
And for it to come from someone outside of oneself or outside of the people themselves, then that is going to be that is going to be preoccupied by mm-hmm. the other people's own vision of themselves,
yeah.
the other people's own vision of their own future, mm-hmm. the other people's own analysis of their own experience, and they are going to project that onto us. Mm-hmm. So that is an unworkable, mm-hmm. an unworkable formula.
Yes.
For any people's liberation, you lose your sense of your own agency when you allow other people to define your reality. Mm-hmm. The word kujichagulia in the Nguza Saba that we observe during Kwanzaa. Mm-hmm. Kujichagulia, to define ourselves, name ourselves, create for ourselves, and speak for ourselves instead of being defined, named, created for, or spoken for by others. When we create, define ourselves, our own essence is embedded in how we define ourselves. If we allow others and our own agency is expressed mm-hmm. in how we shape and how we approach our own liberation. If we allow others to do it, then it will deny us of our own agency, deny us of our own our own capacity to think for ourselves, to do for ourselves, to be for ourselves.
Yes, indeed. Baba Obi Egbuna says, Black power demands a total rejection of whiteyism, without or within. To talk black power, we must first clear up the mess inside our soul.
Oh, that's
before
so
we can effectively reject whiteyism. This is a technical terminology, yes. You know. It's just as valid as bourgeois and working class and proletariat and petty bourgeois and capitalist, whatever. Yeah, whiteyism is a term, intellectual terminology for a social force.
Hence the saying by Baba Wade Nobles.
Yes.
You know, power is the ability to define reality and have others respond to your definition
as if it was
their own.
Indeed.
And so if we are allowing others to define our reality, who better to define our reality but we ourselves?
Yes. Indeed.
If we allow others to define our reality and define our course for liberation, then what we are doing is that we are surrendering our power to them. Other people are exercising power whilst we as a people are surrendering our power to others.
Says before we can effectively reject whiteyism in the street, we must first and foremost reject it within the very marrow of our being. It must be rejected because it has no right to be there.
Mm-mm.
To do things for ourselves, we must first make sure we are completely ourselves.
Word song.
That's deep, you know. He said, to do things for ourselves, we must first make sure we are completely ourselves.
That's right.
Before we can confidently say we must first ascertain we really mean we. Not half us and half them. Sounds like race first to me, brothers and sisters.
This is what we call word, song, and power. Power.
Indeed, kings and queens.
Sorry,
indeed.
I interrupted you.
Yes, indeed. You're in tune to Africa Suites with Alkebu-Lan, kings and queens. I just realized I've committed the cardinal sin of not giving out the numbers, kings and queens. We're going to be interacting with one of our brothers from the Uhuru movement in a bit, after which we'll open the lines. But for now, we're receiving your texts on 07-438-154-351. Once again, that's 07-438-154-351. We are discussing the life and legacy of Baba Obi Egbuna. We were hoping to be joined by his son, Obi Egbuna Jr., who, due to some miscommunications, has found it difficult to join us. But we shall be endeavoring to link up with him, because he did agree to do the show, but he had some miscommunication, and so that's caused a complication, kings and queens. But we're just honoring the life and legacy of Baba Obi Egbuna and asking the question, 50 years of black power in the UK, how are we doing? Were our brothers and sisters aware of the work of Obi Egbuna? You know, have you heard his name before? What do you know about this man? And to what extent have we maintained the Black Power movement in the UK since the 1960s? Stay tuned, kings and queens. We'll be back after these messages. Yes, indeed, kings and queens, you're tuning into Africa Suites of Alkebu-Lan on Galaxy Radio, the only de-brainwashing station. We're asking, 50 years of black power in the UK, how far have we come, kings and queens? We're honoring a life in that context of Baba Obi Egbuna, who, with the publishing of the Black Power Manifesto in the 1960s, signaled the definitive moment in the rise of black power as a movement in the UK. Baba Obi Egbuna has many, as a playwright and an author, has many publications that are currently out of print. But do your research, kings and queens. You'll find a play by the name of Wind Versus Polygamy, The Minister's Daughter, and The Madness of Diddy. He also has a number of short stories and non-fiction political and analytical books. For example, Black Power or Death. How you mean? Serious title. Mm-hmm. The Murder of Nigeria, An Indictment, dealing with the Biafra War, kings and queens. That's the book that Brother Lee mentioned earlier that inspired Baba Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah. Destroy This Temple, The Voice of Black Power in Britain, which is said to be influenced somewhat by his meeting with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad when he went to America.
Mm-hmm.
The ABC of Black Power Thought, 1973. Yeah, so you know, this is obviously a serious man that
you can tell. That's why they were titled those
books.
You
where know, my God,
this is a strategic thinker.
Yeah, man.
You know, and this is a determined person. You know, this man was seriously committed to driving the force of African revolution forward, and so we have to respect him for that. And just thank you very much for reading those very very awesome words. So profound, the words that you read just now, you know, that basic analysis that he was giving of the need for us to know ourselves and be ourselves. And it's summed up in the slogan that the Alkebu-Lan Rivals movement used for many years: freedom begins with the freeing of the mind and soul. But I also want to, because we're still honoring the life and legacy of Mama Frances Cress Welsing, and last Sabbath we had Mama Marimba Annie on our show, and one of the things that we didn't manage to do is to talk about the inspiration she gained from a man called Neely Fuller, whose name she always called and to whom she had always given credit. And Baba Neely Fuller, in a discussion, was asked about the need for us to reclaim our land, you know, especially on the African continent, the need to reclaim land. And he said something very similar to the words that you read from Baba Obi Egbuna just now, where he said, we always talk about reclaiming land and the need to own land, and he said that it's so important, but he said we're never ever going to own land until we own our own minds again. Yeah,
serious thing.
And we don't talk enough about the need to reclaim our own minds, to own our own minds, because and he went on to say something, and he said it even more profoundly than I'm able to even recall the actual words, but he went on to say that because with the state of mind that we have presently, even if we were to reclaim our own land, it would still be in the ownership of our oppressors, because our oppressors still control our minds.
Yes, yes, yes. Serious thing.
Tendai Mari.
All right, Brother Leader, we do want to come back to one of the anniversaries that you mentioned at the top of the show. Because this is the anniversary of the New Cross massacre, we do just want to honor specifically the lives of the young men and women who perished as a result of what we consider, well, is considered to be a suspected racist firebomb attack. Kings and Queens, justice has still not yet been done.
Absolutely.
And so we want to keep their names alive.
Absolutely.
Right now, brothers and sisters, so bear with us as we have a little libation moment for the young men and women who perished as a result of the New Cross massacre. Tendai Mwari.
Tendai Mwari, and whose name we will continue to call and we will ever remember. And brothers and sisters, I want to remind us that today, this date, the 18th of the first month in this year, 6256, so-called 2016, is the 35th anniversary of the New Cross massacre, which took the lives of 13 of our young people. A 14th also having fell to his death or jumped to his death as a result of the mental afflictions that he suffered from that traumatic experience. The names of those who were martyred on the 18th of the first month, January, in the year 1981 are as follows: Andrew Gooding, age 18. Owen Thompson, age 16. Patricia Johnson, age 15. Patrick Cummings, age 16. Steve Collins, age 17. Lloyd Hall, age 20. Humphrey Godfrey Brown, age 18. Roslyn Henry, age 16. Peter Campbell, age 18. Jerry Paul Francis, age 17. Glenton Powell, age 15. Paul Ruddock, age 22. Yvonne Ruddock, whose party it was, age 16. And in July 1983, 2 years later, our beloved young brother, Brother Anthony Burbick, who was 18 years of age when he suffered the trauma of the New Cross Massacre, at age 20, on the 9th of July 1983, jumped to his death from a high-rise estate. We remember them all, and we will continue to remember them. And we pledge on this day, as we continue to pledge, that the blood of these 14 young people will not be shed in vain. Out of the ashes of the New Cross Massacre, we, Africa UK, we the sons and daughters of Africa, domiciled in the part of the world called the United Kingdom, will organize ourselves and build a nation for the empowerment and the liberation of African people here in the UK, on our mother continent, and throughout the entire African world. May the martyrs of the New Cross Massacre, may their souls continue to rise and rise like Ra on the wings of Ma'at. May they continue to empower us in the fight for our total liberation. The glory of Mwari Nyakusika, God the creator of the universe, and the attainment of a much higher quality of human existence. Amen Ra.
Amen Ra.
Asheo. Tendai Mwari.
Yes, indeed, kings and queens, Tendai Mwari, you're tuned to the Africa Speaks of Alkebu-Lan on Voice of Africa Radio. We just gave honor to the lives of those who perished in the New Cross Massacre, kings and queens. We should never forget those names. And on the subject of not forgetting, we are honoring one name who many of us have forgotten. Many of us didn't know about, so who has been forgotten by our collective African community, the name of Baba Obi Egbuna, godfather of Black Power in the UK, kings and queens. And we are asking, 50 years of Black Power in the UK, how are we doing? How far have we come? One of the questions that we're looking at, kings and queens, this evening, is the question, we're relating this to the Metropolitan Police's recent call to double the number of armed policemen in London to the tune of, double. So there were 600, now there's going to be 600 more, kings and queens. Yeah, in response to terror, you know, basically whatever they call terrorism nowadays, kings and queens. It's very, very interesting that this has taken place. In the spec, we gave the example by way of response in terms of historical context of the Ring of Steel in London. There was a Ring of Steel, what they call the Irish Republican bombings, basically. Irish people were looking for freedom, you know, from, you know, the United Kingdom, because England has oppressed everybody, including their own people. And so there was a police response in relation to this Ring of Steel, where Irish people were apparently bombing out the place. And as a result of this police response, Africans were disproportionately stopped and searched in the 90s, kings and queens. When they were looking for Irish Republican bombers. And that's interesting because we spoke about Obi Egbuna being a victim of state attack. And he was arrested and charged with incitement of violence against police. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, when you check the context for that, Brother Leader, in 1965, the Race Relations Act was passed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And this was basically the result of activism in the UK that led to British society, the British government, having to pass a Race Relations Act to, one, stop discrimination in employment, mm-hmm. and, two, in response to racial attack. Mm-hmm. And one of the things is that you can't incite violence against somebody because of their race. But what many members of the Black Power Movement were arrested under the Race Relations Act. And it appears that Baba Obi Egbuna was one such person. Another brother, was arrested because apparently in a speech at Hyde Park, Speaker's Corner, he said he urged colored nurses to give wrong injections to patients. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Colored bus crews not to to take the fear of black people, so give black people free fare, ride upon the buses. And he said for Indians, restaurant owners to put something in the curry. Apparently, this is what he said. Allegedly, kings and queens. This is what this brother had said. But they accused Obi Egbuna of inciting violence specifically against police.
Mm-hmm.
Again, Notting Hill riots. Yeah, white youths running around, kicking in the doors and aggressing African people. African people are arrested for possession of an offensive weapon. Mm-hmm. Not grievous bodily harm or anything like that. Possession of an offensive weapon, mm-hmm. which is obviously an act of self-defense. Mm-hmm. So when we look at this, Brother Leader, put this into context for us in this day and age. Yeah, when they say terrorism and they're looking to put 600 more armed police, Babylon,
mm-hmm.
on the streets, what should that say to us as African people in this time with the benefit of that historical analysis?
We should be seriously concerned. We should be seriously worried as a people about the implications of this for us, for all the points that you have made and for all that was stated in the spec that was read earlier on. Mm-hmm. Because of when we look at the relationship between us and the state, and in particular our relationship with the police, it is one of historical repression, one of, you know, historical mistreatment that we have had at the hands of the police. And in any analysis that we make of the criminal, our connection with the criminal justice system, we will see at every level we are disproportionately facing repression and facing injustice.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, if we look at the statistics in regards to deaths in custody, we will see that African people are disproportionately represented in these statistics. Now, you know, a gun is one of the most efficient ways of taking lives.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've seen in the case of Azel Rodney, mm-hmm. in the case of Mark Duggan,
mm-hmm.
in the case of George Asari, which we don't seem to remember, a few years ago, even though he didn't die, he was shot, mm-hmm. and tasered, shot about 5 or 6 times by police and tasered,
mm-hmm.
and by some miracle, he survived it, although he was critically ill in hospital. Mm-hmm. And of course, recently, that young brother, and his name slips me at the moment, in Wood Green. His name will come back to me in a minute. Jerry Baker? Jermaine Baker. Was shot and killed by the police.
Mm-hmm.
You know. And almost every time you hear about someone being shot and killed, mm-hmm. you can almost guarantee mm-hmm. that it is an African.
Yes. All around the world.
Not just in the UK, but we find the same thing in the United States of America.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And what is also of deep concern is the extent that this so-called terrorism
mm-hmm.
is being used to justify
mm-hmm.
the militarizing of the government's domestic policy.
Mm-hmm.
It is becoming more and more, the police are becoming more and more militarized. You know, and we have to be concerned as a community as to how we are going to protect our young people, in particular our young men, from what the fallout of this is likely to be.
Yes.
More African young people, young men in particular, being gunned down on the street by British police officers.
All right. Give thanks, brother leader.
And we are just not organized enough as a community, as a nation of people, to mount any serious resistance to this or to protect our community in any effective way, and we should be very, very concerned about
that. Yes, sir. All right, give thanks, brother leader. We are opening the lines, kings and queens. Apologies for the late opening of the lines. We were trying to get one of our standing guests on the line, so we didn't want to interrupt that particular process. But the lines are now open. 07-498-538-770. That's 07-498-538-770. Brothers and sisters, you may call in Yes, and text in on 07-438-154-351. All our listeners in London, all around the UK, all around the United States of America, and apparently even in Macedonia. I can't remember where Macedonia they are, but somebody's tuning in from Macedonia, kings and queens. So we do give thanks. Yeah, well, we're African people there, Greece. So it looked like, you know what I mean? So we give thanks. Mama Kai.
Brother leader, now, you said that you're concerned about the implications for, obviously, African people because of the history of the police and, you know, our people in the UK in particular. Mm-hmm. Some people say, well, they would feel a lot safer, and if anything, it may protect African young people in the sense that they're less likely to carry a weapon because they know now the police are armed.
Sorry, I missed the question. Sorry.
Obviously, you spoke of the implications of the police being even more armed, but there are some that believe that it would protect the community more because our young people are less likely to carry weapons because the police are armed.
Well, has that been our experience? Has that been our experience as a people? Is it our experience that the more armed the police are, the more protected our communities are? Is that the case? I named just now four African young men who were gunned down by the police. I could name a host of others who were killed at the hands of the police, maybe not with guns, but it could mean that when the police are more armed and there is a campaign for the police to be armed, for the police force to be armed, so not just to have armed response units, but for all the police officers to be armed.
So do you think then, brother leader,
it means that they will have more efficient means of killing our young people, and it would suggest that the disproportionality of the killing of African people, and the names I was starting to say, the people I named, the young men I named, were all unarmed. All of them were unarmed young men.
So do you think, brother leader, and we do have a caller
when they were shot. Sorry.
Yeah. Brother Kwame will be joining us in a second. But do you feel then that the opposite would take place, that more of our young people then would arm themselves?
Tendai Mwari, well, you know, I don't know if I'm in a position to predict that, but what I do know is that guns come into our communities, into the hands of our young people, that do not come from our communities. They come from outside of our communities. And what I do know is that police officers and police stations have been busted in history and found to have been involved in pushing guns and drugs in the African community. So I hope that it would not mean that we would have situations like that developing or continuing in our community, because our young people are vulnerable and can easily be led, so many of our young people can easily be led astray. Tendai Mwari.
Brother Kwame, Tendai Mwari, welcome to Africa Speaks with Alkebu-Lan. Our discussion this evening, 50 years of black power in the UK, how are we doing? How are we faring? And obviously now we are looking at the recent situation where the Metropolitan Police are going to be 600 more officers are going to be armed. Would you think it's going to be good or bad for the community, and why?
Tendai Mwari, family.
Tendai Mwari. Tendai Mari, Brother Kwame.
In terms of your answer to the first question, the answer is a realistic no, in terms of that we have not really used the ideals of black power to emancipate it from the conditions that we are living in. Because what I've said already is that two things. Our minds, the majority of our people, believe it or not, accept it or not, but the reality is there in our actions and what we do. The majority of African people living in this country have enslaved mindsets and are still suffering from post-slavery trauma disorder. And because we're suffering from a disease that we do not know that we are suffering from, this does not allow us, as Brother Leader says, to organize ourselves as a people. And because we are not organized as a people, we have been failed to invoke the templates and the teachings of our fathers, such as Marcus Mazaigavi, such as Malcolm X, and etc. So the simple answer is no. We've got nowhere in 50 years. Look at our condition now. We still send our children to slave plantations called schools. There was a report that was out in 2008 that got rubbished by this government, that black people or African people in the UK are the most imprisoned people on the planet, even more so than America. Right? We look at our healthcare. People don't talk about the healthcare of our people in this country. The healthcare of black people, of African people in this country, is at a crisis. If you look at the list for prostate cancer and cancers in general and other diseases, we're at the top. And I could go on and on and on. You look at our economic activity. Just this Kwanzaa, many of our people spent billions and billions of pounds, not with our own people, but with our enemies, the Asians, the Europeans, the Chinese, etc. And then you come around and tell me that we are a community. We are not a community because there is no community among us. Primarily for the purpose of two things. Our minds are still enslaved because of the traumatic post-slavery disorder system that we are suffering. And more importantly, that we are not organized. And this is why the Metropolitan Police Force, in their arrogance, and the police force are one of the four pillars of white supremacy, of the global system of white supremacy. They can enact this ordinate activity that they're doing to arm more police officers. And this would be a direct threat to our community, particularly living in the Bay of the Beast in London. Because, as you are well aware, black or African people in London are at least five times likely to be suffering search than their European or their Asian counterparts. So that is the reality of our situation, brother.
Okay. Thank you very much, Brother Kwame. I really appreciate your contribution this evening.
And just before I go, just add to that, the notion that our dear beloved mama, Francis Cress, wasn't left us about the ethos of white supremacy, how it works, how it functions. If we understood what Dr. Francis Cress wasn't said, we wouldn't be in the condition that we're in. Mm-hmm. And we'll enact strategies like a chess game to combat the ills of white supremacy. Tendai Mari.
Give thanks, Brother Kwame, for that contribution. Always insightful and instructive. Once again, kings and queens, you may do the same on 07-438-154-351 and also 07-498-538-770. We are asking the question, 50 years of black power in the UK. How are we doing in the context of the life and legacy of Baba Obi Egbuna, godfather of black power in the UK, a very, very serious man, one of the unsung heroes that we're shining light on today, kings Absolutely. And queens. And also in light of this recent announcement of the Metropolitan Police, a.k.a. the Dirty Babylon, increasing their armed police presence on the streets of London, kings and queens, and the implications this will have for the African community. Very, very serious, kings and queens, and necessary for us to explore these permutations of our current context. Tendai Mwari, Mama Kai.
Tendai Mwari. And Brother Leader, some people may say that we're overreacting in terms that the Metropolitan Police has made it clear they're dealing with, they're putting these armed police response unit in specifically to do with terrorist attacks.
Mm-hmm.
It's not to do with black men walking up and down on the street. It's to deal with terrorist
or even
attacks.
Gang violence.
Well, we've already had the analysis of how the Ring of Steel, for example, which was supposed to protect London from the excesses of the IRA, and yet we ended up being disproportionately stopped, disproportionately harassed and arrested, you know, in the last decade and a half, with post 9/11, when we're supposed to be, you know, concerned about terrorism. What we have seen is the proliferation of stop and search of African people on the streets. In some areas, you're talking about 30, 40 times more likely to be stopped and searched and harassed compared to Europeans.
Yeah, but is that stop and search to do with terrorism or stop and search to do with gang violence?
The point is that it seems to be the case, the evidence seems to suggest that whatever is the cause for police in the UK to step up their action to suppress any form of what they perceive to be unlawfulness, African people seem to suffer the brunt or seem to suffer the fallout from that. That is a concern. I think that's a genuine concern that Africans a right to have,
yeah,
because of the evidence of history. Okay. Tendai Mwari.
We have Brother Ade. Tendai Mwari, Brother Ade, you've heard the discussion thus far. What would you say to the question, do we really... Sorry, not that one. Would more armed police make you feel safer?
How are you doing there, everybody? You okay, Brother Bandaka?
Tendai Mwari.
Yes, Brother Ade.
Yes, Brother Ade, good to hear from you.
Yeah, I have to agree with what Kwame said. I mean, it's difficult over here, you know, to so-called have black power. You know, such a thing doesn't exist at all. I mean, are you talking of the police? I mean, don't forget the old people. I mean, they can do whatever they like, because at the end of the day, this is their country. And as regarding community, I mean, the oath, no community will thrive over here. I mean, you mentioned that you can't see the element of superiority. I wouldn't say the Indians or the Chinese, those who are doing well over here, are better off than us personally, because the Europeans who own this would not allow no community to face up. Not in the doorstep, anyway. And that is the stark reality.
But there are communities that are doing better, that are prospering, that are more organized than our community. What would you say to that?
No, not in hindsight. No, not at all. Not in hindsight. Like I just mentioned to you, they will not allow you, because they will refer you, regardless of who you are. You are not classified as ye olde English. You are never classified. The man who said you have been a British person, but you're never in ye olde English.
Okay. Give thanks.
I mean, for us personally, I mean, our power, the only way we can attain black power as a race and as people and as a so-called community, as you alluded to, we have to get that black power in Africa. Mm. You know, and there is no comparison to us over here and to our so-called brothers over the other side of the Atlantic. In fact, I think their plight is even worse than over here.
Mm-hmm. So do you see our fight as a global fight that we have to be fighting, whether we're in the UK, whether we're in Africa, wherever we are?
Yeah, but Brother Bandaka mentioned defilement. I mean, I don't personally, if I see a person who looks like me, whose name don't relate to me, I don't take them personally. Whether it's Arabization the name or European ethnic name, I don't take them seriously at all. Names is very important to me. And it's got to be African-centric, an African-based.
Okay.
I believe it is that anyway.
All right. Thank Give thanks. A very important introduction to the discussion. Brothers and sisters, that's Brother Ade. And he's saying that, you know, he doesn't take it seriously. He doesn't feel black power has made any impact on our communities thus far. And certainly he agrees with Brother Kwame's position that we haven't moved on the legacy of what our elders and maybe our ancestors have provided for us. Brother Ade also feels that Africans who don't carry African names, he doesn't take really serious. what's your view, Tendai
Mwari? It appears to me that the essential question of the evening, Mama Kai, is whether we need the resurgence of the Black Power movement in the spirit of an Obi Egbuna in 2016. in relation to the to combating these injustices and continue plans for further injustice. We have another caller on the line, kings and queens. You may or may not want to answer that particular question.
We have Brother Bob. Greetings and welcome, Brother Bob.
Yeah, welcome. Good evening.
Good evening.
Tenamari.
I think I'm going to be quick because I haven't got much credit. I must use the word relative towards the term black power. Similarly, compare it with white supremacy. It's all relative. It's all a relative thing. But it needs to have a purpose, the terminology. And I must agree, it was a movement. It wasn't really a slogan. It has to be a movement because of the word power. So basically, we are actually experiencing the effects and the results from that period of time because we're more sure for a circumstance. And about the police business, that's going to happen anyway because the country needs to protect itself because that's their first policy is to protect the country. So we're just going to deal with that. And
what should our response be then? You say we should deal with it. How?
No, we're going to have to deal with it. We're going to have to behave ourselves and obey the law. It's simple. If we obey ourselves and obey the law, stop killing each other, the police guards are none to us. Anyway, as I said to you, right, not much credit tonight, so
Don't worry,
Brother Bob. We hope that, you and your telephone provider sort out your differences still, So give thanks for that call. Give thanks for using your last piece of credit to phone Africa Speaks with Alkebu-Lan on Galaxy Radio. We do fully appreciate that.
Did you agree, Brother Bob, brothers and sisters? Do we need to just sort it out?
And start killing each other?
What
I'm telling
you. And then, the people that will leave us alone, maybe. Yeah. Then I'm right, the number to call.
07438154351. Alternatively, 07498538770. Kings and Queens. We're dealing with the subject Black Power. 50 years of Black Power in the UK.
Brother,
how are we doing?
All right. Brother Leader, so what do you say to Brother Bob's position that this is the people of law. It's obvious they're here to protect their country, their state, and it's inevitable that they were going to up the militarization of their country. And, if we want to get on in this place, we just have to, keep the tail quiet.
Tendai Mwari, it's an analysis I have to admit has gone straight over my head. I don't understand where Brother Bob is coming from. I can't pretend as though I understand where he's coming from. We must not forget our history. We must not forget how we came here. In the first place, as African people, we must not forget the Maafa, the history of the invasion, the conquest, the enslavement of our African continent and our African people, the colonization, near colonization. And we must not forget that we came here in the 1950s and 1960s, or let's say from the Windrush 1948, to rebuild this country in its bomb-shattered state after we had shed blood and died in their World War II, and after we had given our last penny to also fuel the war effort from the Caribbean and from Africa. And we were cajoled into coming here in the 40s and 50s for opportunities. We have come, my parents' generation came and worked very, very hard and have been discredited even for that. So, I don't understand that kind of reasoning. I can't pretend to understand it. But we just must remind ourselves of why we are here. Tendai Mwari.
Tendai Mwari. We do have a text. It says, last strong on the regional news, there was a report of a residential place in South London for our African elders. The building is filled with cockroach and rodents. This whole situation is an abomination and disgrace. What are we, the African community, doing about it? Tendai Mwari. That's from 494. Nice to have a name, though.
Yeah, Tendai Mwari. What we need to do and what we must do is organize ourselves as a nation of people with the institutions with a range of institutions that can address the complex and varied needs that we have in our community. Our elders need quality and substantial care, as do our children. Our children are being snatched from the bosoms of their mothers and fathers and their homes and being put in so-called care that's happening right throughout our community. They're being taken outside of our community, our geographical as well as our cultural community, and being placed out in the sticks, something that was happening in the 60s and 70s, and we fought in the 70s and 80s, and forced councils, local authorities, to adopt same race placement policies. And now we have allowed them, within the space of a decade and a half, to roll between the 90s coming into the 200s to 2000s, to roll that back, and then now snatching our children from our grasp once again. And we are not organized to do anything effectively to stop that from happening. And this can only happen, or can best happen, if we're organized as a nation of people. And that's what the vision of the Interim National African People's Parliament is about, brothers and sisters. We can talk about the problem. We can recite the problem. We can sing it. We can dance it. We can make poems about it, brothers and sisters. But until we organize ourselves and build institutions and pool our resources, get our experts together to deal with establishing programs and institutions that can address the specific needs that we have in our community, we'll be in the same position in 5 years from now, 10 years from now, chanting the same woes. We must organize.
Yes, indeed, kings and queens. And that is your cue to come down to the International African People's Parliament next General People's Assembly, dealing with the subject of economic empowerment, key to our liberation. And don't feel say, INAP just start doing economics, you know. Some people are going to say, INAP just start talking about economics yesterday. I mean, now, you know. Foolish is that. Long time you talk about the thing, all right? So, that's Saturday, my day, the 30th of January, 2016, 4:30 to 9:30 at the West Indian Ex-Servicemen's Association, 150 Clapham Manor Street, brothers and sisters. I do want to ask, brother leader, on this subject of black power, you see,
we're going to be dealing with that in more detail next week.
What's that, sorry?
The INAP.
Okay, economic empowerment and movements.
Boogies.
All right? So good movements, yeah?
Yeah.
Yes, indeed. So we have a couple of events to announce before the end of the show, kings and queens, so do stay tuned for more information. But in relation to black power, brother leader.
Mm-hmm.
We wanted to deal with the relevance of being an artist, but we're not going to have time to deal with that today. But we should deal with this. One of the things that black power and nationalism brought to the movement, yeah, that other ideologies that were more Marxist leaning didn't, is the emphasis on culture, cultural awareness, cultural understanding, in terms of our Africanness.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard Brother Obi Egbuna Jr. speak and say that his father was a Pan-Africanist in the truest sense of the term. He barely recognized himself as a Nigerian or even an Igbo man, which he was. Right. But he believed he was a Pan-Africanist.
That's
so
right.
Everywhere that he went in Africa, mm-hmm. he was an African.
That's right.
And mm-hmm. understanding that culturally. And one of the quotes that Brother Obi Egbuna Jr. says from in his reasoning with Kwame Ture, he says that Kwame Ture said something like, this Pan-African stuff that we're talking about politically, it's been in our culture long before. Mm-hmm. We're just trying to catch up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the importance of the black power movement, mm-hmm. and the nationalist Pan-Africanist movement bringing the importance of culture, mm-hmm. into the liberation fight?
Tenai Mwari. Well, let's deal with black power, no?
Yes.
All right. What is power?
Yes.
Power is the capacity to effect your will.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Will is a determination to be that which Mwari Nyakusika, God the Creator, created us to be.
Mm-hmm.
Let's reflect on the words that we read earlier on about from Baba Obi Egbuna stating the importance of being ourselves.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah. So power is a capacity to effect. When you have capacity to effect your will, to bring your will into being, and we're talking about our collective will, then we have some power.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? If you can make things happen, mm-hmm. then you have some power.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we talk about black power, we're talking about, black is just a poetic reference to African people.
Mm-hmm.
The black is the color of our skins.
Mm-hmm.
African is the substance of our beings.
Mm-hmm.
So we just refer to our skin tone as a poetic reference to our substance, which is African.
Yeah.
So we're talking about having the collective capacity as African people to effect our will. And that can only come through organization.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the next part of your question was about nationalist Pan-Africanism,
the importance of culture, because both the Black Power movement had a strong cultural essence to it.
Okay.
But that was fueled by the nationalist sensibility, if that makes sense.
Yes.
So I'm putting them both in the same bracket.
Uh-huh.
But in terms of what they brought in terms of culture and understanding itself as an African, African culture as a tool of liberation, what's the importance and the significance of that aspect of it? Like Baba Obi Egbuna said, we must get the YT-ism.
Mm-hmm.
So what when we get the what is in us that we're trying to replace the YT-ism with?
Well, culture is a collective personality of our people. Think about a person with a personality. Think about a person without a personality, and that person is almost non-existent. That person doesn't really exist. Your personality is the natural expression of your being. So our collective personality is the collective expression of our being as African people, and it expresses our nature of being. Yeah. So that when a people are oppressed and when a people are culturally oppressed, what the people do is assume the personality of the oppressor in order to feel some sense of humanity. You have to go outside of your natural mode and modalities of expression to feel some sense of humanity, because the society in which you live only recognizes you when you step outside of your natural mode of being or your natural expressive modalities to give you recognition or to reward you for your work or your services or your existence, to even acknowledge your existence. But when we create a system within which we recognize ourselves, we have a system that is mechanized to recognize us as African people for being African people, that rewards African people for giving services for the empowerment and the liberation of African people, then this is how a culture works. This is how a culture functions. Mm-hmm. And this is how culture is used to empower a people and empower a nation of people. So we have to restore our natural cultural modalities.
Yes.
We have to restore our own spiritual systems. Mm-hmm. For example, we have to restore our languages, our names, our rituals, our ceremonies. All those are expressions or manifestations of our African culture.
Yes, Brother Leader, as the saying goes, the best way to defeat an alien culture is to live your own. Obi Egbuna says, profound, you know. To do things for ourselves, we must first make sure we are completely ourselves. So deep, don't worry. We have a number of events, brothers and sisters, to announce before the end of the show. So do bear with us, kings and queens. But first of all, as we announced last week, we would like to re-announce the Omowale Malcolm X Observance Season, Kings and Queens, which will feature for the first time ever on the shores of the UK a tour by Baba Zach Kondo, controversial, hard-hitting warrior scholar and author of Conspiracies Unraveling the Assassination of Omowale Malcolm X, arguably the number one book published on the subject from an African perspective. Kings and Queens, do Google that if you know not about that work. But he shall be joining us from the 25th to the 28th of February, Kings and Queens, dealing with revolutionary African-centered education for African people, as well as the subject of unraveling the assassination of Omowale Malcolm X, Kings and Queens. That weekend will also feature the OMX Storm, a night of edutainment dedicated to the works, life and legacy of Omowale Malcolm X. For information on all of these events, Kings and Queens, you can go to alkebulan.org/OMX Observance. Once again, alkebulan.org/OMX Observance. Basically, go to the Alkebulan website, Kings and Queens, and you will find information on the Omowale Malcolm X Observance is coming for the end of February. We urge you all to be there. Baba Zach Kondo is a warrior scholar for over 30-40 years standing, Kings and Queens, and we guarantee you shall benefit from his insights. We also have Kings and Queens, continuing with the honor to our great ascended Queen Mama Francis Cress Welsing, the No More Sessions Fear of a Black Planet, the legacy of Mama Frances Cress Welsing, taking place on Kuumba Day, Friday, the 29th of January 2016. Kings and Queens, the message will be delivered by myself, Brother Tafadzwa Shakara Bandaka, and we're going to be going in on the life and legacy of Mama Frances Cress Welsing, its significance to today, and welcoming, in fact, encouraging all challengers and would-be naysayers to the legacy of Mama Frances Cress Welsing to come and bring your challenge to that session, and we shall nyam you accordingly, kings and queens. All right, but no, I'm joking. But we have some challenges going on in our community right now, kings and queens, and we do welcome you to come to the session and share your perspective, and we shall debate following the presentation in the spirit of African love, unity, and revolutionary forward movement, kings and queens. Once again, that's Friday, the 29th of January at Mama Africa Culture Shop from 7 p.m. You can also find the information for that event at alkebu-lan.org. We want to reiterate the Interim National African People's Parliament General People's Assembly on the 30th of January, also dealing with economic empowerment, key to nation building. We shall be dealing with that subject next week, kings and queens, so do stay tuned to Africa Speaks with Alkebu-Lan. We should also note that the 23rd of January is the community memorial for Mama Frances Cress Welsing, to be held at the Mama Art Centre, 166A Tottenham High Road, Kings and Queens, from what time? N17. What time? And I forget the time.
Right,
now.
The time has slipped me.
Yeah,
that will come up in a moment.
Yes, indeed, kings and queens. But is that the Mama Art Centre? If you all on, I should have the liquid leap, but here we go. That's right from the hour of we're getting there 3 p.m. 2 p.m. kings and queens, starting 2 p.m. to 9 p.m. on the 23rd of January, kings and queens. This has been Africa Speaks with Alkebu-Lan, and we have been honoring the life and legacy of Baba Obi Egbuna. Tune in next week, where we'll be diving into the upcoming GPA, General People's Assembly for the International African People's Parliament. Economic empowerment, key to nation building, kings and queens. This is the only D-Brain watching station. Tune in next week as we continue to talk it straight and make it plain. Around here we say,
Tendai Mwari.
Thousand midnights, African ancestors, it is to you that we, your children, give respect and honor. O ancestors, we call upon you and welcome you.